Hello, everybody, and welcome to Facebook Live. I am glad you're joining me this week, and we are on a different day today, of course. Today, we're a little early. We're doing this on Wednesday, November the 22nd. That's because tomorrow is Thanksgiving in the United States, and I thought it would be hard for some of you to watch me. So I know you'll be spending time with family and friends, so that's why we're doing it today. And if you are in the States and are going to be celebrating Thanksgiving, starting probably tomorrow and through the weekend, I hope you have a wonderful time and are grateful for all the things you have in your life, because I know we all have wonderful things in our lives. So if you're joining me for the first time, I'm Kim Jamieson-Hirst of Chatterbox Quilts. And if you are one of my regular viewers, thanks so much. I love seeing you here every week. If you're joining me live, say hi so I know who's with me today. And thanks for taking time out of your day right now to watch me, especially on a Wednesday rather than a Thursday. If you're watching the replay, please jump in too and say hello and let me know if you have any questions. After we're all done the broadcast, you'll have the opportunity to go through the whole thing. And if you still have some questions, please put them in, because I do go through and I read all the comments and I love to answer and help you out if I can. Now, if you are watching me today, either live or on the replay, I hope you'll get in and help out with what I'm going to be talking about today, which is my favorite quilting books, my top 10 must-have quilting books. So what I'm talking about here is reference books, ones I've had for quite a while, most of them, ones I find very helpful, whether you're a beginning quilter or more advanced, ones I think are worth buying and having in your quilt studio, either as a physical book or as an ebook on your computer. Hello, Michaela. It's good to see you here with me today. And I hope you're enjoying some nice weather. We are going through some warm weather coming our way in Calgary. This morning I woke up and it said it was 11 degrees Celsius on my weather app, but when I went outside, my car said it was -4 and then it dropped to -7. So apparently in part of Calgary, it was much, much warmer than other parts. Calgary is interesting that way, but anyway, so we have a nice bright sunny day today. So I'm grateful for that today. Let me just go over a few things here. If you are joining me and you are enrolled in my community quilt along, the third block, there's four blocks in it. The third block just went out on the weekend, so I know some of you are working on that. And I am, you know, the end is in sight almost. We only have this block and next month's block. So if you've been following along and doing the blocks every single month, you will have it done before Christmas, at least the quilt top. Maybe not quilted, but hey, if you're that good, that is fantastic. So remember, if you are interested in joining that quilt along, you can always go to my website at www.chatterboxquilts.com and you can find information about my quilt alongs that I offer there. And the one we're working on right now is community. So if you're wondering about wanting to join and you think it's too late, it's never too late. There are videos and patterns and everything. And once you join, you'll get everything up to where we're at, which would be the first three blocks. And you can do it anytime you want. I mean, it's not like you have to do it along with everybody else. You can do it at your own pace. You could even start it in January as a project if you wanted to. All right. Hello, Heather. Nice to see you with us too. All right. Let's go into something else here. Just a few reminders that if you aren't already in my private Chatterbox Quilts Facebook group, that you can always join us by going to www.chatterboxquilts.com/fbgroup. We have quite a few people in that group. We're getting close to 1,000 now, which is amazing. Very helpful, supportive group. The idea of that group is to share ideas, to share information, to help solve problems, increase everyone's knowledge so that we can enjoy our quilting more, because that's what it's all about. Also, if you're not getting free content, because we put free content out every other week, that's in addition to these Facebook Lives and in addition to the YouTube videos they do as well, you should be joining us. You should be getting on that mailing list to get some free content. So to do that, you go to www.chatterboxquilts.com/free-content. And you'll receive things about every other week we send things out. So you can jump in on there anytime and you can start with us and move through and get all the previous ones we've already sent out as well. So now we wanted to talk about quilt books. All right, so if you don't know, I have a huge library of quilt books. I have lots of books. We are a book family. We love to read. We all love to read. And thank goodness we have a really good library system in Calgary, or I would have spent thousands and thousands. I'd be in the poorhouse for the amount of money I'd be spending on books, not just me, but in the whole family. So I have a lot of quilt books, and I'm constantly adding and taking away from them, but I love going to places and finding older books. Ones are out of print, ones I haven't seen before, because there are still some of those, and picking up some of those too. So some of the books I'm talking about today are ones that I got when I first started quilting. Other ones are ones I picked up as I've gone along that I know are good reference books. And as I say, some of them are ones that may be a little more difficult to get, but they are good reference books to have if you can get your hands on them. So after we're done the live video today, I'm going to put a list of these. I'll have a list of these in the description above the video so that you can see exactly the titles of the books and who they're by, who the authors are as well. So jump in here. Let me know whether you've got these books, whether you've heard of these books. Let me know what you think are great books to have in your quilt library. And so I'm talking more general kind of quilting books. I'm not talking about, you know, ones to do specifically applique or paper pieced, or ones to do, you know, free motion quilting or those sort of things. That can be a topic for another day because I certainly have my sections in my library. But today I just wanted to go over these ones I think are really worth having in your library, and they're ones I refer back to again and again and again. And it's also interesting, depending on where you're at in your quilting journey, something you didn't find, you know, that you were referring to maybe a lot in the beginning, you may start referring to as you move along into different techniques and you want different ideas on them or different people's way of doing things. So keep that in mind too. So it's another good reason to go back through your books every so often, because you may be at a different stage in your quilt journey, you probably are, than when you bought the book. So you may find other parts in it that resonate more now. All right, so when we go through these, I'm going through them sort of in like these are the first ones I would suggest you get, and then moving along as you go through your quilting journey. So the first book, I mean, this is such an obvious one, Your First Quilt Book, or It Should Be, by Carol Doak. Okay, so I'm going to be switching back and forth between cameras here so you can see these close up. And as I said, I'll put a list in afterwards, so not to worry if you didn't get the title. Okay, so, you know, you got to have this one, right? It says you need to have it. So why do you need to have this book? And it's a paper, I have a paperback version. I think that's what it is in it now. And it's been out for quite a while, actually. It's produced by that Patrick Place, which is Martingale. And this is a book with about the basics. There's a few color pictures in it of some quilts, but not a lot. So it's mostly black and white graphics. So when she's talking about blocks, you'll see that they're black and white. Maybe I'll just stick on this camera for a while. I don't want to keep going back and forth. So you can see that they have black and white, but they're very clear. And you can see what exactly she's talking about. But it goes through the basics. So she starts in, she's got a glossary at the beginning. So if you don't know what people are talking about, when they talk about, you know, a backstitch, or they talk about bias grain, things like that, you'll find that in the book. So she starts out with a glossary, which is really good because then you've got the terminologies she's going to be using throughout the book. And then she goes into information about fabric. She talks about tools. So all the basics you should have, supplies. And then she gets into talking about patchwork blocks and the different grids. So you might have a 5-patch, a 4-patch, a 9-patch, how you can determine what that block is in case you want to make any changes to it and that. Also, what sizes. So if you have like, I'm trying to think here, like a 4-patch, you know, you want to count by 2. So when you're increasing the size in that, you know, 2, 4, 8, that sort of thing. A nine inch block is not going to work very well if you're trying to put a 4-patch into it. It's going to have some weird numbers, weird sizes for those little parts in the block. So she kind of walks you through that. And that's really helpful too, especially when you first start off. It can sometimes be tricky to figure out, you know, is this a 4-patch, a 5-patch? What is this? Because this is the instructions I have for it, but I want to make it bigger. So how would that work? So she walks you through how to do that. She shows you how to sew pieces together. She talks about borders, quilting. So all the basics are in this book. So it's really good to have, and of course it says it's your first one you should have. So I find that this is a good book to have for beginners, and because it takes you along step by step. She also talks about hand piecing or machine piecing and hand quilting or machine quilting. So that's something you don't see in every book. You know, maybe they're focusing on hand piecing and quilting rather than machine, or vice versa. So also good information in that book. So that's a good handy little book to have. It's a nice small little size too, so it's easy to take with you. And there's some cute little cartoons and stuff in it as well. So it's easy to read, good information. It was not the first book I bought. I know, awful, eh? But I added it to my library later on because I knew it was a good one to have, a good reference one to have. The next one I have, this is kind of two things I had. This is Color Play by Joan Wolfram. Probably most of you have seen this book, I would think. You know how important color is in your quilts, how important value is in your fabrics, in your quilts. And this is one of the books you want to have that's going to walk you through how to make those choices, why those choices are important, why they work and why they don't work sometimes if you don't make the right choices. So what she does is she has the different color schemes. So you have analogous, it's hard to say, complementary, there's triadic, there's all these different color schemes. So she walks you through these, and she's using colors from nature, mostly. So she says, that all the colors you're looking at, you can pretty much find them all in nature. And she walks through different colors, and she shows you the different shades, tints of them as you go along, and then she'll walk you through different. Let me find, I don't like yellow, so let me find a nicer color. I don't want to show you the colors I don't like so much. Let's go into some nice blues or something here. She walks you through, talks about them, shows the different color schemes, and she shows you fabrics too, which is kind of cool. So some of these fabrics you may even have in your stash. You never know, depending on how old your stash is. This book is a few years old. But then she also shows you different quilts that are made using those different color schemes. So you can see how they fit together into a quilt, which is of course very helpful because it's one thing to talk about them, but you really want to see how does that all fit together and what's the end result going to look like. So she has quite a few different quilts at the end of each area. I think she has about eight of them thereabouts. Yeah. So here's another one. So in shades of purples, different ones. So there's lots of photographs in this book. Lots of, I like the fabrics that she shows as well, because that's, like I said, really handy. And when she shows them, so for example, here, she's showing you in nature what it looks like. Where am I? Over here. So you can see the colors she's picking up out of nature, and then she's using them here into a different color scheme. But you can see actual fabrics. So you know you can go into a store, you know you're going to be able to pick up different fabrics, and you know it's going to work. So she walks you through that. So lots of reading, lots of thinking in this book, I would say. It's not something you just flip through and go, oh yeah, although you could flip through to a color scheme and see what colors you'd be needing to pull. And then to help you out even more, we have the 3-in-1 color tool, which I'm not sure why it's in the big thing because it's just little like this. And this is sort of like painter's swatches, but they're color swatches. So it goes with the book. So she's got the different swatches, the different colors, like she does in the book. And you can see there's different colors, different tints and shades of the colors when you actually get into that particular color swatch. And then when you look on the back, you can see she's got the different color schemes on there and shows you what other colors you would be putting with that particular color and how you'd choose them off the color wheel. So the idea behind this is that you would take this with you or to the store or even in your stash. You'd match up. So if I'm looking for, this particular blue, which is the pure color right here, let's say, I could match that into my stash, find that fabric that's as close as possible to that color, decide what color scheme I want in the back, and see what other colors I need to pull. And those other colors are going to be in here as well. So if you're looking at the oranges, for example, there's a different oranges here. So I could go in here and find that shade, one of the shades in the orange, and then use that to either pick fabric out of my stash or pick it out of the store. So this is a helpful little gizmo. It's got these guys. It's called the Ruby Beholder and the green one. So those are supposed to show you, look at how nice it is on my jacket there. It'll show you contrast between colors. And so depending on which color you're looking at, whether it's, or which shade you're looking at, whether it's red shades or blue shades and stuff, you can use them. So personally, a lot of people swear by these. Personally, I have a hard time seeing a difference with them. That's just me, I guess. Depends on your vision maybe or how you view colors. But certainly the color swatches are really handy. So this is really handy to have with color play. Get it back in its packaging there. So that's really great. So, you need to understand color and how it works. And I must admit, it's one of the things I don't like getting into. It's probably one of the things most quilters know is really important, but really hate to think about too much, right? But this will make it easier for you for sure if you go through and understand the principles and you know the different color schemes. These have them in it. You can always refer back to it because I can never remember what's a complementary one, what's a triadic, split complementary. It's just so many names. And so that book is really helpful for it. And then you've got the color tool, so it'll help you pick those fabrics that go in those shades. Oh, and by the way, guys, I got a mic on today, so let me know if you can hear me, if this makes a difference. Can you hear me well? I kind of like to know about that. So I'm wearing a mic today. We got a mic that works with this program. So hopefully you can hear me really well today. All right, let's just see who else is joining us to say hi. Another, hey, we got two Heathers in the group. Love it. Hi, Heather and Rob. How you doing? Flavia, is that Flavia? I hope I'm saying it right. Or is it Flavia? Might be. Another, oh no, let's have Heather again. Gosh, I thought we had like three or four Heathers in this group. I'm going, wow. We got two Heathers with us today, but that's great. So thanks, guys, for joining me. If you didn't come in right at the beginning, I will have a list of these books that I'll put in the video description afterwards, so don't panic if you don't get the titles and authors written down. Keeping with color, another one, Color Mastery, 10 Principles for Creating Stunning Quilts by Maria Piegler, is another really good book too. I love Maria Piegler. If you're not familiar with her, check her out online. She is great with a lot of things. She does a lot of business things as well online for people, helping with social media and things like that. She has courses. So she is a really good reference person for a variety of things. In Color Mastery, it's going through color again, of course, but a little bit different. So same kind of color schemes you're going to be looking at, but she kind of approaches them in a different way. But she also has the 10 principles of color mastery that she goes through at the beginning, and she's talking about your hues and tints and that, and then she gets into the different color schemes. But it's I don't want to say it's a workbook, because that's not true. There's lots of information in this, but she does give you the opportunity to build your own color wheel. She suggests you have a journal, that you actually take pieces of fabric, put in them when you're trying these different color schemes out, that you can actually make, you know, use your fabrics to make the color wheels that you're going to be using in that particular, not the color wheels, but the colors you're going to be using in that particular quilt. So she actually has a color wheel template for you that you could copy and just stick your fabrics in there, which is helpful. And then she goes through all the different schemes. So she's got this in each, so let me just see if I can show you here. She's got this for each color. So here's her blue. So she's showing how she creates that. And then of course she's got that blank template for you to use as well. So besides talking you through it and explaining things, she also gives you that opportunity to actually create your own color wheels, to build your own schemes for the different color schemes. And then what she does at the end of the book, or partway through the book, part two, is she has quilts that you're going to make. So she has the instructions for the quilts, and they are illustrating the different color schemes that she has. And there's 9 different quilt patterns in here. So she will explain what you're doing as you work through each of those and what color scheme each one represents. So I found that really helpful because, you know, if you actually go through the process and make something with it, that's going to cement that knowledge in your head. So the opportunity to use it as you go along and learn exactly what the color schemes are and make a quilt and see how it looks in that quilt will be really helpful for you, I think, to understand those concepts really, really well. So I like this book. I like the approach she's taken with this one, slightly different than Color Play. It's not quite as, I guess, a traditional approach, maybe, you might say, but still lots of really good information in this book, really helpful. And I really like the fact that you can use it as like a workbook and go through and actually make those color schemes, put your fabrics in there, and see what the results are going to look like. All right, the next one here. Press for Success. Now, I'm not sure if this book is still in print or not, and I never had this one initially either, but I've heard so much about it that I had to get it. This is by Myrna Giesbrecht. Myrna Giesbrecht is one of our Canadian quilters. I don't know her, and this book was published in 1996, so I'm not sure if she's still quilting or not or what, but this particular one is all about pressing. Now, that sounds pretty basic, right? And maybe a little boring, but you know, if you don't have good pressing technique, if you don't understand which way to press, you can have a real mess in your quilt. Pressing makes a really big difference. And what is pressing as opposed to ironing? So if you have been quilting for quite a while, you will know what that's about. However, if you're new to quilting, you know, you want to get the basics down right so that you don't start into some bad habits. It's like when you cut and close, cut and close, cut and close. I learned that in my first quilt class. It becomes a habit right away. You never have to worry about an open cutter sitting on my cutting mat, I guarantee you. When you work at a quilt store, that's a different thing, because one of your coworkers might have left the cutter open on the mat. Not a good thing. Anyway, but at home, I always cut and close, even if I'm going to be cutting another strip in just a second. It's just a habit, and it's a good habit to get into. So much like that, good pressing habits are really good to get into too. So she talks about the difference between pressing and cutting. She shows you how to press different yardages and how that works as well. And then she goes and talks about, can you see here? Which way are we here? There we go. Pressing plans. So she has a pressing plan. So that is the way you are going to press your seams in your blocks and eventually in your quilt to get the best results. So what you're looking for is a smooth, flat quilt top, right? So she suggests that you set up these pressing plans, and she explains, I should say, in this one, understanding pressing plans, why you would be doing this, what you're looking to achieve. And then she shows you through some different blocks what a suggested pressing plan would be and why. So that the goal here is that you will eventually take your own quilts and be able to come up with a pressing plan if a pattern doesn't, you know, if you're not following a pattern, you're doing it on your own, or even if the pattern doesn't tell you which direction to press, because sometimes they don't tell you that. And she goes through all different shapes. So she's got squares, rectangles, triangles, and into other shapes too, hexagons, curved piecing even she gets into. So it gives you a really good basis for understanding why you should be pressing in certain areas. And then she actually goes from your block to block, and then, like I say, into your actual quilt. So borders and everything, she covers all of that as well. And then, again, I like this, so it's not quite a workbook, but she has exercises in the back. So she gives you a quilt, and she asks, you know, which direction would you be pressing? And you know, breaks it down into different little pieces in there, and which way should you be pressing here, and why, and what's the end result going to be? And if you're really worried that you might get those exercises wrong, don't worry, because like any good textbook, the answers are in the back of the book. So if you're really not sure and you're really stumped, you can go to the back and look and see what she suggests you do, and you'll understand why she's suggesting that. So just a small little book, but Press for Success has a lot of really good information in it. And I like the fact that you can actually, that you know, they have exercises in the back. I like the fact that she explains why you're doing this. So again, it'll make sense to you, and that's something you can carry forward into any of your quilt projects. So Press for Success is a good one. Okay, what else do I have here? Oh yes. The art of classic quilt making. Okay, how could you not have this in your studio, right? The art of classic quilt making. So, you know, it sounds like it's a really good reference book, and it is. Okay, this is one of the first books I actually added into my library. This is Harriet Hargrave and Sharon Craig, who've been around the quilt world for a long, long, long time. When I hear their names, especially Harriet Hargrave, because she has other books that I'm going to talk about in a minute, I think about detailed, thorough instructions. I mean, she doesn't miss anything. So this book has like everything you need in it, basically. Now, it's a little bit older too, so some things might have changed a little bit, but for the most part, you know, your basics don't change, right? So while some of the examples of the fabric and stuff may look a little older, you know, you will still have good basic information in this book. I'll start reading here if I'm not careful. Okay, so so what she has here is she'll go through everything from choosing fabric, different kinds of fabric. I have to read because I wrote all these things down because there's so much stuff in here. She talks about your tools. She talks about studio setup even too, which is kind of cool. So things you should consider, what you should have in your studio. But I mean, in great detail for all these things. So it's really interesting to read any of Harriet Hargrave's books because she has that attention to detail and that very thorough approach, and everything is in there in very logical formats. I'm guessing, I don't know her, but I'm guessing she's an extremely organized, methodical person because of how her books are written. So again, I come back to this book a lot because it's got good reference information in it. She talks about needles, she talks about thread, she talks about irons, you know, she tells you about how to draft different quilt blocks and stuff and how those all work into great detail, so you can see some of the information that she has in there. And then once they go through there, I should say, then they get into, you know, cutting strips. So the thing about this book too is there's lots of really good photographs that illustrate what she's talking about, what they're talking about, I should say. I'll not forget Sharon Craig too, co-author there. And then we get into settings. I have to keep going here to get to the part I want to tell you about. Sashings, planning your quilt. Okay, that's also a good one. And then she gets into basic strip piecing. Again, there's pictures all the way along here. And then she starts in with oh my gosh, I'm going to keep saying she, with strips and squares. Okay, so we're going to go through some quilts in this book. We're going to make some quilts in this book, and we're going to start simple. So you start with your strips and squares, and she has several that she works through there. And then you go into triangles, of course. So the two of them are working their way through from simple quilts to a little more complicated quilts. Again, all kinds of information and lots of quilts, because I'm sure there's no shortage of quilts you could photograph from the two of these authors. So really, really good information in this. Something I refer back to again and again and again, because she covers all kinds of things. She gets into set in piecing later on. Borders, all kinds of borders, batting, you know, quilting. Now, she doesn't get into a lot of quilting. But that's, you know, a topic for another book. You can write a whole book, as lots of people have, about that. But anyway, I love this book. It's a good heavy book, too. It's a good book. to have in your library for sure. C&T Publishing does this one. I'm sure it's still in print, that one. Okay, I'm talking too much. I need some tea. Okay, another one that I've had for a long time is the Quilter's Ultimate Visual Guide. So this one I like a lot. This is actually articles from different quilters that are in here, and it's like an encyclopedia. So it goes from A to Z by different quilting topics. So for example, if you start with A, you have album quilts. So there will be an article written about what an album quilt is and sort of the history of it and that sort of thing. And then you go through applique, and there's all kinds of photos, and there's lots of illustrative diagrams in this book. This is a heavy book too, actually, even though it's paperback. But they're all written by different quilters. But they're very comprehensive within each one. And I come back to this time and time again, excuse me, whether I'm going through binding, I want to look at different ways of attaching my binding at the end, whether I'm talking about, quilting feathers, for example, or different quilting techniques, hanging sleeves or hanging techniques, I should say, because there's more than one, obviously, and they go through different ones, quilt, care, and storage. But it's all alphabetical. So I like that about it because it makes it really easy to go through and look for a topic. So I don't, sometimes you want to look at a certain thing and you're not sure exactly where in the book it was, or you've forgotten where it is. There's an index at the back, so you can look up what you're interested in. Say, bias press bars, for example, is even in here, and it'll tell you what page to go to. Lots of good information in this one. As I say, I do refer back to this over and over again. So I like this particular one. This is from Rodale Books, actually. They have different really good quilting books, too, on different specific areas as well. Rob says he loves Harriet. Yes, who doesn't? Who doesn't? I've got a lot of her books, actually. Another one I've had for a long time is The Simple Joys of Quilting. Okay, this is by Joan Hansen and Mary Hickey. Sort of similar to the, I forget my title here, The Art of Classic Quilt Making, but not quite in depth. I don't want to say quite in depth. That doesn't sound right, because Harriet Hargrave goes deep on her subjects more than anybody I think I've ever read. But this one is very similar. Like, they start off with your basics, and they start off talking about fabric and pinning and pressing and all these different things. And then again, they go into making different blocks and different quilts. And they're starting off with the squares and rectangles. There we are. Squares and rectangles they start off with. And then we'll get into triangles, and we'll move ourselves along through curved piecing. So again, similar idea. And I don't know, I like these quilts in this book too. I find the quilts appealing. I don't know, they're kind of classic designs in some ways, but not in others. I don't know how to explain it, but they're appealing. I guess that's why I should say they're appealing. So here's ones with big triangle blocks, as you can see. But I go back to this one because I find that there's a lot of designs in here. They're simple enough to make quickly, but also interesting. And I find they're good to refer to when I want to make something. Like if I have, matching yardage, or I have a bundle of fat corners, I come back into here and I find different ones that I like to make. So there's another one there. Now that one, when I look at that particular one, I'm looking at that negative space in the middle, which is great for, a quilt stencil free motion quilting. It's good for machine applique, or not machine applique. Well, yeah, machine applique. I meant machine embroidery, or even hand embroidery that could fill in those places. So I think that these quilts in this book are quite versatile. They are quite traditional, really. But I could see how you could use them with modern fabrics, different fabrics than what you see in the book here, and they'd be really effective too. So I really like this book, The Simple Joys of Quilting, and as I say, I've had this one in my library for a long time. It's one of the first ones I got as well. All right, moving along. Okay, let's switch it up totally. Let's go into The Practical Guide to Patchwork, New Basics for the Modern Quilt Maker from Elizabeth Hartman. Can't even say her name. Elizabeth Hartman, sorry. Okay, so this one looks a lot different from the ones I've shown you before, mostly because it's using more modern quilt fabrics. Again, she goes through the basics, so she does a very good job about that, talking about your materials and supplies. I think I'm getting tongue-tied today. Materials and supplies, she goes into whether you should wash them or not, and I find that her stuff is, as the title suggests, more modern, because she's talking about pre-cuts and things like that, which most of the other books don't address that, right? I think at the time they were written, we didn't have jelly rolls and charm squares. We had fat quarters, but not the amount of pre-cuts we have now that are really, really popular. So she gets into more of that information, a little more up-to-date, maybe, I guess I would say. But she also talks about the supplies, and she talks about you know, fabrics and choosing fabrics. But you can see the choices in her book are all bright and modern looking, right? So I think that's what's different about it. It's the way the whole book looks different, right? But she goes through her rotary cutters and how to cut, and lots of pictures in this book too. So this is a really good reference book as well. And we get into quilts, of course, after she gets through all the basics and everything. And one thing she does show you in here, she talks about quilting with a walking foot, and then she also gets into some free motion quilting designs as well. So she does address quilting a little more than some of the other books do, and gives you some examples as well. So I like that. And then when she goes to show you how you're going to put a quilt together, we start with like a rail fence, and we're going to move through some squares and rectangles, and then we're going to get into triangles. So a similar progression from the simple moving forward. Always a good idea to do that, especially with new quilters, right? Because you want them to be successful, so they want to move on. And she has them divided. So you're starting with beginners, and then we go into a confident beginner. So you got some strip piecing in this particular one and some other examples as well. So I like the way this book is set out. It just feels really fresh and modern. And of course, how can you not like a book that's got a kitty cat on there? That looks like my first cat I had, Smokey. He was a gray cat like that. Anyway, it's just lots of good information in this. I think this would really appeal to a younger quilter and younger by younger, 40 and under, I guess. But I can see because of the colors of the fabrics in the book, because of the designs, it speaks modern. But a very good guide as well. Of course, more recent book. There's 12 quilt projects in this book that you can make. So again, if you are trying to get someone into quilting, this might be a good book for them to have to start off with. Moves through the basics, continues on. And then, here we get to a big heavy book. Judy Hopkins, 501 Rotary Cut Quilt Blocks. Aren't you guys proud of me? I haven't had one applique book up yet. Now, come on, you got to be proud of me. Okay, so if you want to do sampler quilts, or if you are looking for rotary cut blocks and you want to see how to make them in different sizes, this is it. Judy Hopkins has had different quilt books out on rotary cut blocks. She's no longer with us, unfortunately. But all her books live on, which is great, because she had a lot of good reference books of all different kinds of rotary cut blocks. And then this is a big assembly of them all. So let's take a look at this one, if I can hold it up. It's a big book. So these are all alphabetical, by the way. So at the beginning, there's a gallery of blocks, so you can see they're colored. And this shows you the block, and it gives you the name, and it tells you what page it's going to be on. So there's your index, as it were. Because otherwise, who's going to remember the names of all these blocks? I mean, I know some of them, but I sure don't know all 501 of them. Then when you move through to the page you're looking for and you want to see what the blocks look like, she's got diagrams for them, and she has different sizes underneath. So depending on what type of block it is, you'll have different sizes, like whether it's a 4-patch or 5-patch, 9-patch, whatever. But then she's got the sizes of the blocks you can make it in and tells you the sizes of each individual piece in that block. Okay, they don't show you how to put them together. There's a diagram so you can figure that out yourself. But you got a whole bunch of different sizes that you can work with. So I think the biggest size is 12 inch. I'm not sure that's accurate. Depends on the block. 13 and a half. There's a weird size, for a block. So they're different sizes, but basically under 14 inches, I would say. But this is really great because you can go through, you can pick out the different blocks. You can figure out what size you want, figure out how to put it together and everything. So really good reference book to have in your library, especially if you like sampler quilts or if you like to do not rotary cut, I would call them piece blocks is what I call them. If you like to do piece blocks all the time, this is a really good reference book to have because it covers so many quilt blocks. If you're not happy with 501 quilt blocks, I don't think you'll ever be happy. All right, coming up to the last one, number 10 that I have of these kind of reference books. Ta-da! Mastering Machine Appliqué by Harriet Hargrave. Okay, there's my appliqué book right there. Okay, I've had this book for a long time. This is an excellent book, okay? If you don't like appliqué, too bad. You have to listen to me talk about this book. Okay, so one thing I like about this book is it's coil bound, okay? So it lies flat. And there has been many a time where I've been working on my machine, finishing off edges, and I'm wanting to refer to her instructions. And I have that book open right next to the machine. It's great. I love, love, love coil-bound books. I know some people will take their paperback books and have them cut, like the edges cut off, the binding cut off, and have them coil-bound. I have not done that with any of my books, really, but I certainly appreciate when a publisher puts them out in coil bound because they will lie flat. So again, we're going to talk about applique here with Harriet, and Harriet gives you all the information. So she's going to go through, she even talks about sewing machines and needle sizes and all that kind of stuff, thread. She goes through it all. She goes through all your different fusible webs. She goes through your stabilizers, how to prepare your fabric. You know, she covers it all, right? She talks about tension even and stuff. So a lot of things that she gets into, I mean, she gets in deep. Oh, Heather loves applique. Yay. Okay. There's somebody else here with me, another addict. And then she goes into all your different types. Okay, this is all like fusible web, but she talks about if you're doing satin stitching or if you're going to do a blanket stitch on the edge, how to prepare your templates, your fabric, how to trace your patterns on there. Like, just great information. And then lots of really, really good photographs as well in this book to take you step by step through it. And you can see, okay, you can probably see in the top, see a little pink, little post-it notes that I've got stuck up here because those are areas I refer to all the time. So, you know, it makes it easy for me to find them. But she talks about everything in such easy to understand information that I really appreciate it. I love how she talks to you about the stitches, because you may not realize some of these things, but you know, your stitches should fall perpendicular at a 90 degree angle to your fabric when you're doing like a blanket stitch or a satin stitch, what they should look like, how to go around corners. So you should get really, really good results if you follow through this book. She also goes through, and I don't even know what you call this exactly. So when you're using a template, it's like using a template and then you're putting your applique. It's like you're preparing it for like needle turn applique, or not quite needle turn, but hand applique, if it's for finishing the edges off by hand. But you're actually going to do them with an invisible machine stitch. So she shows you how to do all that. She shows you how to put the design together, you know, how to prepare the templates, all this information. Like, it's just, it's like A to Z, right? And of course, she has examples of her quilts in the back as well. But this is just an excellent book. Now, I have the second edition of this book. There is, I'm not even sure if the fourth edition, it might be actually on this one, but it's definitely still in print. Definitely a good one to have in your library. If you like applique or you are starting to get into applique, I highly recommend this book as a good reference book to go back to again and again, as you can see with my little sticky notes that I have in there. And I just want to see if there's anything else I wanted to mention about that one here. I don't think so. I think I've covered most of it, but yeah, I love the coil bound binding on that. It's just so nice. Don't you wish they were all coil bound? I know it's very expensive to do that, unfortunately, but has anybody ever taken their books in, had the binding cut off them and had them coil bound? I don't know. I know some people that do that, but anyway, let's see. Oh, Rob, that reminds me. Rob says he has three of her quilting books, but he wants one in applique. Yeah, Rob, it's a great book. But I also forgot to mention, and this was what I was going to mention when I was talking about her other book, was that Harriet Hargrave and her daughter Carrie have a series of books out, I should say. They're called Quilters Academy. And so it moves through, I think there's five of them out now. I have four of them, but there's five of them. And they start at the very beginning. Again, these are really thorough books too, right? But I love how they go through the basics. So when you're a beginning quilter, right from the hop, new, brand new, how you go through that. And they talk about studio setup too at that stage. And as you move through each of the books, the projects, you're learning new techniques, a little more complicated techniques in each book. But she also goes back and covers some of the same area again at the level you're at now. So she also talks about studio setup and what you might want to add now when you're at the next level and the next level and that sort of thing. And I think the last one's a master class. I don't have that one yet. I haven't seen that one actually myself. It's been out about a year, I think. So I'll have to get it. But, you know, by the time you've gone through those five books, and I'm not sure if there's going to be more coming out or not. There might be, because they had them come out about every other year. By the time you've gone through there, it's like going through a university course on quilting, really. She's taking you through all the different types of quilting, all the different, you know, curves and foundation piecing and all that stuff. So she takes you through everything. And so I think if you were really, really, really into wanting to learn everything about quilting, those Quilters Academy books would be great as well. I wanted to mention those. I don't have them down here. They're upstairs. We're using them right now for some things. But those are really good too to have. And again, like, I find her books, you know, I don't know if I would work through them all the way through step by step. That'd be a great thing to do. Take a lot of time. But certainly for reference, like, if I want to know something, if I want to know, I don't want to say the right way, but a very considered way of doing something, I will go to Harriet Hargrave's books all the time. because she has been at it long enough and she has explored quilting so much that she has all the kind of the best ways to do things, I would say, if you know what I mean. I don't want to say there's more than one way to do things, no doubt about it. But I like how she'll explain, this is why you do it, and this is the result, and this is why you're doing, so that you will get the best results when you're making your quilts. Okay, so how about you guys? I want to hear what you guys like. Do you have any of these books, or do you have reference books that you go to again and again? I know in the future I will probably go through some, like I say, quilting books, you know, free motion quilting and ruler, not ruler, well, using rulers, but what do you call it? Even feed foot. What am I trying to say, guys? I'm trying to say walking foot. There we go. Walking foot quilting, things like that. So, I mean, I have my library in sections so I can easily pull books like that. So, of course, I have an applique section, which, you know, if you guys really twist my arm, I might go through some of my applique books that I really like. But I have books on modern quilts and that, like, so I have different ones, so I might go through those. But if you have books that you like, just pop them in the comments. Let me know what you like to refer back to, or if there's books that you're wondering about, you know, if there's ones you've seen and you're not sure what they're like or not, you can always ask me, because chances are I probably have it in my library. It wouldn't surprise me. The other thing is I do, and I think I mentioned this before, is before I get a book, if I'm interested in a book, I look it up on Amazon.com. I order through Amazon.ca because I'm in Canada. But I'll look through Amazon.com because they usually have pages that you can look through. I'm going to switch back to my other camera here. So they'll have pages so you can see more of the book. And a lot of times you can, you know, read some of the pages and get an idea for what's in the book and that. But I also check my library. Like I said, we have a really good library system here in Calgary. And so we have a lot of quilting books at the library. If it's not at my local branch, I can have it brought in. So I can also go and take them out of the library. So I will do that sometimes and take them out of the library. And if it's got a lot of information that I feel is helpful and I'll refer back to again and again, or if it's got patterns I like, you know, then I will consider buying it. For me, I usually have to like at least three patterns in a book. Most books have maybe 12 to 15 patterns in it. Maybe probably 12 is probably more the average. So I will go through, and if I like at least three of them, really a lot, then I'll consider adding that to my library. But, you know, they take up a lot of space, and then there's ebooks too, right? I do have ebooks, but I still like a book in hand. But, you know, storage gets to be an issue after a while, unfortunately. So, but anyway, if you guys have any other information that you'd like to see or other books you'd like me to go through, just let me know. Like I said, if you're looking and wondering about a book, ask me about it. I may have it. If you want to know what the best applique books are to have in your library, let me know, because I can sure go through some of those. But I have lots of different ones, so I'll probably do this again in the future if you're interested in that, and show you some of the other books in different categories, as it were. Okay, so if nothing else at this time, I think that's about it for today. I will be back next week on November the 30th. Is that going to be like the last day of November? It is, isn't it? November 30th. I can't believe it. Who started? I know some of you guys have started some of the people in my group, I should say, have started their Christmas gifts. Good for you. Yay. I'm still working at finishing projects. I've been sitting there for 2 or 3 years. So maybe you guys can give me a bit of a kick in the butt and challenge me to get some of those finished and see what I can do, because I pulled them out. They're close by and some are not very big projects. So those are just ones for me. Some of them are ones I've made as gifts for other people, but I didn't make one for me and I like them so much that I am partway through making one for me. So keep letting me know what you're working on there. And again, if you have any topics that you want me to cover, be sure to either pop them into my Facebook page or my group if you're in the group. If you're not in the group, remember to join. So you can do that at www.chatterboxquilts.com/fbgroup. And as I said, I'll be back next Thursday with another topic. And in the meantime, I hope you have a wonderful rest of your day. Thanks so much for joining me today, and I look forward to speaking to you next week. Bye now.